one example, this is a set of regular languages. I think you all know. Here it is a given different way. It is x and y. Maybe in our tutoring, m and n. So there is no such relation between x and y. So it definitely regular language. And remember, within the regular languages, these are the infinite languages. Infinite languages, I've told you, is very interesting. Infinite language is always interesting. Like you can see our English language, infinite language. Every day, new prose, new thing is coming. If it's a finite language, if you have a, say, one particular book, say, the book is contains everything. So that is not the interesting thing. So if you can produce infinite possible languages, meaningful languages, then your literature will be interesting. So that is the thing. So even this finite languages, these regular languages are infinite, and within this a subset is finite languages. That means that is always a finite language, and that is always a regular language, and that can be done by combinatorial circling. Now this is the most interesting area. This is a context-free language. In fact, this area is huge. The nearest part is context-free language is deterministic context-free. See here. The deterministic context-free, we know examples, a to the power n, b to the power n, balanced parenthesis. These are extremely good examples. And these languages are very useful for programming. And beyond that, non-deterministic context-free languages like palindrome, which is very difficult for programming purpose, but that is very interesting also. Next is the context-sensitive grammar. Here, the a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n. Like here, it shows examples 0 to the power n, 1 to the power n, 2 to the power n, or www. You try to always remember by the sample language grammar, sample language, to that which area it is. Like wwr is a context-free grammar, but ww is context-sensitive. So that's it. Then we have this is also two part. One is Turing machine decidable. Decidable is a closer set. And Turing set is recognizable, that is the outer set. These things, say the Turing machine, this is complement Turing machine, this is set. It is a different picture, so I want to show that way. This recognizable very hard term, decidable is softer term. Decidable is much more compliant. Decidable means the language and its complement is also decidable. And recognizable means the language is recognizable, but its complement is not recognizable. So it is a further set. It is a recognizable, or in some books, recursively enumerable language. And this is recursive. Some books it is a recursive, and this is recursively enumerable. As for Sifser, follow the Sifser's book. These things is pumping lemma, and this pumping lemma probably you have heard in the pumping lemma 1 for regular grammar. The pumping lemma 1 says that you can pump. But you have a UVW. See, you have a string X. It consists of UVW. You can pump at one place, say V place, at one place only. Maybe UVVX. So you're pumping there. That pumping may go to infinite, but that is a regular language. And if you pump it at two place, like say a to the power m, b to the power n, I am pumping at a and pumping at b, but there is no such relation, then also it's a regular language. But if we have this pumping lemma 2 says, see, if you have a string, say UVWXYZ, a string, you are pumping at two different places, difference by a few strings, but they are synchronized. That means you are pumping at the same number of times. That is a necessary condition for a context-free language, but that is not a sufficient condition. This is a catch. So if you see the pumping is there at two places synchronized, say a to the power n, b to the power n, or a to the power n, b to the power 2n, say n and 2n, the relation is there, then you say it is it obeys pumping lemma 2, and it is a fit case for the context-free grammar. Let's go for theory. Here it says, take the string Z, it will consist of this is the UVWXY. See, you divide it, it chops it, UVWXY, and the length should be like at least n, n may be a number. Mod Z means this is your string, you take a sample string with sufficient length. You cannot take a very small, you know, sufficient repetition is there, you take this and sufficiently, then you say VWX, this portion, the repetition should be at V and X, and W is the middle portion. W may be null, okay, but your repetition should be at V plus and X plus. So VWX less than equal to none, the middle portion is not too long, and it ensures that both VX not epsilon, it ensures it will not vanish. And if you see this, the UVI, I may be I012 and XI, you are pumping at V's place, you are pumping at X place, it is in L. That is the lemma. What is the lemma? Lemma is less kind of a theorem. This is a very useful lemma to determine what is the language it is, whether it's a context-free grammar, context-free language, whether it's a context-sensitive. So that will help. Let's see the next screen. Yeah. So this is your U, V, W, X, Y. So this portion V and X can be pumped. Okay. And W is not pumped. W is the middle portion. So W may be blank also. W may be epsilon. W may not be there. Like A to the power N, V to the power N. A comes here, B comes here. No W, no U, no Y. So that is the simplest case of context-free grammar. A to the power N, V to the power N. Say here, we are pumping, this is the one pumping U, V, W, X, Y, one pumping, or no pumping, or two pumping, or three pumping. So this is your original string, U, V, W, X, Y. I may not pump, I may pump two times. So now it's come U, V, V, W, X, X, Y. If I pump it here, U, V, 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 W, X, 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 Y. So these are all the telltale sign of a context-free grammar. So this is a pumping lemma too. Okay, this is one interesting thing. The intersection of context-free language with the regular language is a context-free language. See, if you take the regular language, all the rules of the language, regular language is closer is okay. So, but the problem is with come the context-free. You know that intersection of two context-free grammar, it is not a context-free, may or may not be context-free, complement of a context-free grammar, may or may not be context-free. So context-free grammar behave differently than regular grammar. Regular grammar, union operation, concatenation operation, reverse operation, everything is close. That means any regular grammar, you do any operations on this, if you put in reverse, they are also regular grammar. But context-free grammar behaves very differently. So here it says intersection of a context-free language with a regular language is a context-free language. Okay, it is. There's some examples. But you try to memorize, and then we come with some examples. So this is you might obviously say context-free with a, but this is more or less okay. This is no exception. Context-free with a regular, it should not be regular, because that regular has some property of context-free. Another thing I have told you last class, deterministic context-free grammar has another peculiar property. Complement of deterministic context-free grammar is a deterministic context-free grammar. But a complement of context-free grammar is may or may not be context-free grammar. We'll give some examples. So here, the context-free language are not closed at an intersection and complementation. That I have taken all this from John Hopcroft Bruce. That book is available with you, the soft copy. That is the best book. So please see this page number. The context-free lemma are not closed under intersection and complementation. Obvious. So if you see A to the power N, B to the power N, C to the power N, and A to the power N, B to the power N, C to the, you make a intersection, you should get the language A to the power N, B to the power N, C to the power N, and that is, we know it is not a context-free. It is a context-sensitive. So then definitely that rule doesn't valid. So intersection of context-free grammar is not a context-free. How to remember? We take two context-free languages, we take the context-free language A to the power N, B to the power N, C to the power M. This is a context-free. We take another language, B to the power N, C to the power N, A to the power M, it is another context-free. So if you make a intersection, that definitely the language will be a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n. But we know this a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n is a context sensitive grammar. So definitely the two context free grammar intersection may or may not be context free. Okay? May or may not be. We cannot say it will be context sensitive grammar always. Okay? Here, this is a definition, I take it the Hopcroft Toulmin's book. This is a push order, essentially a finite automata, yeah, that you know, and this is a stack. Stack should be, what I have told, stack should be empty, your input should be at the last end, and it should be at the acceptance stage, and it will go accept or reject. Okay, so this is a very simple diagram of, I take the John Hopcroft book, and remember in Hopcroft book they take the symbol as a Z0, and Sifser book they take as a dollar. So you must be conversant with the, both the symbol notation. Yeah, I hope so. Yeah, this is I have covered in some other book, Harry's book. That book also is available. That book also treats PDA very well. PDA is a very difficult chapter, but Hopcroft book is very detailed and very good. If you follow only one book, I will suggest you follow the Hopcroft book if you want to follow. Chapter 6 and 7 is there. This is a very interesting sign. This is the your definition of PDA, everything you know. Q is the number of state, sigma is the input alphabet, gamma is the stack alphabet. You know stack alphabet may be completely different with the input alphabet. It should consist of the end of stack marker in Z0 or dollar. This is a transition function. This is drastically different between deterministic PDA and non-deterministic PDA. In deterministic PDA, the transition function doesn't take care of the epsilon transition. So it must consume something from input, and it must push or pop a knob, it may not do anything, from the stack. That is for deterministic push-on automata. But non-deterministic push-on automata, it may not consume anything from input. It may push and pop many times in the stack, but only at the top of the stack. It may push epsilon there also, so nothing can happen there. And so that is a non-deterministic PDA, like for accepting the palindrome. Now that is very difficult sometimes to comprehend, but the deterministic PDA is much more simpler. Anyway, so this is the last day I covered from the that book. This is your configuration function. That is not so simple as simple as your finite state machine. Here it is says Q is the state of the finite state machine from among this capital Q. And AW is the string, input of the string, AW. So what is the first input here? A. A is the visible to the PDA. Okay. And W is a string. A is a terminal, W is a string of terminals. And this is the stack. And what is the top of the stack? It is a capital X. Capital X means is the stack alphabet. We always in this Ullman's book, they use the capital X as the stack alphabet. Capital anything is the stack alphabet. And this is the top of the stack. Now, this is a called operation. This is this particular turnstile. The particular name is the turnstile. Particularly it is used for PDA. In Turing machine also you can use turnstile. Then after one transaction, Q goes to P state, when your finite state machine with the PDA goes to P state, it consumes A. It will shift, so it consumes. So right now input is available W only. So it takes, it gobbles up A, but it reads A. It go from left to right, it reads A. And now what is happening here? It pops X. It pops X and push alpha. So this is your typical configuration step of a push down automata. You have to design these steps to accept the A to the power N, B to the power N, or this kind of language, W hash WR, that we have covered from the Harry's book. So there may be 5 steps here, maybe 8 steps there. Number of A's and number of B's are equal. we know these are the 8 rules that are there. So this is one rule. I just repeat, this is the input state, this is the current state, this is the input string which starts with A, and W is a string of terminals. This is the top of the stack. Top of the stack is visible, capital X. Beta is the after X, maybe later at Z0. So, and after one step, Q state to jump P, okay, and A is consumed, A is consumed, W is there, and you pops X and pushes alpha. Now, if you see the stack is empty, or your W is empty, and your P is in accepting state, then we say the string is, then the last point, the string is, the machine is accepted the string. That's it. This will idea that consuming A, which may be epsilon, that is a non-deterministic PDA, from the input and replacing X on the top of the stack by alpha. Yeah. We can go from state Q to state P. Yeah. Note that what remains on the input W, what is below the top of the stack beta, yeah, this is beta, do not influence the action of PDA. Obviously, because in action which influences PDA is the top of the stack and input which is reading and which state it is at. So, anything content beyond the top of the stack, it doesn't affect the PDA. And this is turnstile, star means you make a number of transactions. That I last class I have covered you. This is this thing. Here one interesting thing for non-deterministic PDA, there may be several pairs that are options at PDA in some situation. For like here, what is there? The top of the stack X, input is A, state is Q, and it goes to P, and now your top of the stack is X is popped and YJ is pushed. So it is a single pop, X is popped, YJ push, comma, it go to R state, not going to P. So Q go to R state, and top of the stack is epsilon. So there are two. So from this is a non-deterministic PDA. So this is from, not only it can go from Q, it can go to P also, it can go to R also. When making a move of the PDA, we have to choose one pair in its entirety. We cannot pick state. So what he said, we cannot pick a state from one and stack replacement string of another. That is obvious. So you cannot say I'm going to P, but I push the stack epsilon. No, either from there you have to take this rule, or either you have to take this rule. Not you take I go to P, but my stack is epsilon, that is not there. That it mentioned is there. When making a move of the PDA, remember this is a non-deterministic PDA, we have to choose one pair in its entirety. We cannot pick a state from one and a stack replacement string from another. Okay, that's great. Thus, in state Q, with X is on the stop, reading from input, we can go to the state P, replacing S, or this is or, either you can go this, or you could go to state R with pop X. Popping X, putting epsilon. However, we cannot go to the state P, that's it. You cannot mix and match. Okay, this is there in the Hopcroft book. This is very interesting. There are lots of your multiple MCQ questions in exam, and fully dependent on this. The context-free languages are closed under following. Union is obvious. Concatenation is obvious. Closure means zero or more occurrence, and positive closure means one or more occurrence. So that you remember. And what is homomorphism? Homomorphism, very name is big, but it's very simple. You replace each symbol with another symbol. Okay, from different set. That is homomorphism. I say change A to alpha, B to beta, like this. This is called homomorphism. It may be a group of terminals also. A single terminal may be a group of terminals, but all distinct. So homomorphism, all languages are closed under homomorphism. Regular, context-free, context-sensitive. Homomorphism is a very simple thing. You are replacing symbols, basically. One is to one or one is to many. And that is always closed. So, but this is a big term. Sometimes you may be confused, and all the languages are closed under all operation and homomorphism. That's it. Reversal. That is, the CFLs are also closed under reversal. That is great. So if you put a language which is reverse, it is a context free language. It is obvious. So reversal, all languages are closed. Not only regular grammar, context free grammar, context sensitive grammar, all are closed. This is L is a context free language and R is a regular language. Then this is the example. This intersection of context free and this is regular language. This is context free. Is a context free. So this is a typical diagram. It is a regular language and this is a context free, and it is ending it. It accepts it. It is a context free. You see this diagram from the Hopcroft books. This is very important. They are following a true about context free language L, L1 and 2 and regular language. L minus R is a context free language. Okay. What I have said, L in intersection with R is a context free. Now it said L minus R is also context free. So this you must try to visualize and memorize. This is very important. Complement of a context free language, not necessarily context free. This is a lot of questions which come, but it is not true for deterministic context free. Complement of deterministic context free is a deterministic context free. But if you take the general purpose context free, complement of context free is may or may not be context free. We try to give examples. Two context free language minus, this is a context free language minus another context free language. Necessarily context free. This looks strange. For regular language, it is a regular language. R1 minus R2 is always a regular language. But L1 and L2 may be context free, maybe different language altogether, maybe context sensitive. So this is it. So you have to visualize these rules. So intersection with regular language. So what we have known, context free language, intersection with regular language is context free. Let's try. See here, we learn this. CFL are not closed under intersection. That is example. That so it is comes to the context sensitive. So it is not. So definitely, these two language. If you make intersection, it should be context. It is not a context free grammar. It is the context sensitive. So intersection of two context free may or may not be context free. This is very interesting problem of context free language. Right now, what we have done. Undecidable problems, we have impressed upon you that Turing halting problem is undecidable problem, because that is always the best examples of undecidable problem. What is undecidable problem? Undecidable problem, you cannot have any algorithm for this. We know the if you have a piece of paper, you with a picture, definitely good picture, then you make the pieces of paper maybe 64 pieces by 128 pieces. Then if you want to get the picture at the back, again, it is not an algorithm, it is a process. You have to take each picture and take to first picture, second picture. So it is it depends on your number. If it is a huge number, there is no algorithm, it is a process. So this is called there is no algorithm. Then another example of algorithm, no algorithm is there, Turing halting problem. What is a Turing halting problem? Says that you cannot design a Turing machine which input you are giving a configuration of other machine and you always say the Turing machine will halt. Turing machine will may halt or may not halt. If the Turing machine doesn't halt, that Turing machine always goes to looping. When the Turing machine loops also very simple. Turing machine goes only one step right, one step left. It cannot be stationary, and it may read or may write, but it must stop someplace. So if it doesn't stop, then Turing machine doesn't halt. If Turing machine halt means it's good, so it may be accept, it may be reject. You can see it from the whether the final state machine of the Turing heart of the Turing machine, it is accepting state or it is a rejecting state. But if the Turing machine looping, then Turing machine doesn't halt. That is example of undecidable problem. The same is here. If a context free grammar, if the grammar is ambiguous, we know the grammar, a language can have many grammar, maybe all grammar, 10 grammars, maybe 9 is ambiguous, one is unambiguous, then we call say that language with this grammar is unambiguous. But to find a context-free grammar, whether it's ambiguous or not, then you have to try and mix. Okay, you cannot, there is no such algorithm, you have to try. Is the CFL is inherently ambiguous? That is also an undecidable problem. You have to, in some case I have shown you examples are trivial, like I say AIBICI, when I are J or J are K are equal, you are making a two context free language, say L1 and L2. L1 is AIBICJ and another is AIBJCJ. Make two union, that is not a context free language, so, and that is inherently ambiguous. This is also difficult, so it will have to, this thing, is the intersection of two CFL is empty? This is, I have not touched upon it. Whether two CFL language, there is intersection empty or not, this is the undecidable problem. Are the two CFL are same? This is also undecidable. They are generating the same language. Say, I have told you, a language can have many grammar. Two context-free languages, whether it's generating same, so this is undecidable. If you're given CFL equal to sigma star, okay, all possible, then when a sigma is the alphabet of the language, so these are tough issues. You can take it as your examples for your problem. Yeah, the inverse homomorphism, I told you, homomorphism, any language is always closed. Inverse is also, most languages are closed. Okay, so just that to show examples. Consider PTA to accept inverse homomorphism. So any language is closed under homomorphism, and inverse is most of the languages closed. But this diagram look interesting. You can see it at the book. This is we have almost covered this context-free. Now we are shifting to other context-sensitive grammar. The context-sensitive grammar is always generate this kind of thing. And another example is WW. So two examples of context-sensitive grammar. A to the power n, B to the power n, C to the power n, or 0 to the power n, 1 to the power n, 2 to the power n, and WW grammar. So AC. This is the best example of context-sensitive grammar. And you see why I call the context-sensitive. You cannot generate this string with the variable. The variable should have some other variable or terminal, at least one. So that means you should have context. It cannot be, so that is the reason it is called context sensitive. Okay, so that's it, the reason of context sensitive. There's another very particular nature is context sensitive grammar is similar to Chomsky's normal form. Remember this, Chomsky done all these things, from definition of regular grammar, Chomsky's normal form, excepting the Greiberg normal form, which is done by Shaler Greiberg. Now, same form, context sensitive form, says every context sensitive grammar can be written with the production of the form. Like your context sensitive grammar requires left hand side maybe any string with a variable of terminal. But like Chomsky's normal form, whatever we have done in context free grammar, we limit the right hand side only two variable of terminal. What is the advantage? Advantage is parsing is much more easier in computer. So that is the reason for Chomsky's normal form. Any context-free grammar can be converted to Chomsky's normal form. Same as if you put Chomsky's normal form in context-sensitive grammar, it is called Kuroda's form. He's a Japanese scientist. So here it says same. This is a kind of Chomsky's normal form, but here it is not Chomsky's normal form. Here left hand side two variable, right hand side two variable. Only two variables. So your right hand side only two variable, or left hand side a single variable, or this kind of variable, two variables. And this is a Chomsky's normal form. This is all context sensitive grammar can be converted to Kuroda's form. Proof is very similar to Chomsky's normal form. Proof is beyond our syllabus, but you should remember, like Chomsky's normal form, context sensitive grammar also can be rewritten as Chomsky's normal form. Then we call it Kuroda's normal form. And only example is left hand side maybe two variable and right hand side two variable or single terminal. That is Chomsky's normal form. So context sensitive grammar, type 1 grammar, this is type 1. A context sensitive grammar is a unrestricted grammar in with every production has a form alpha to beta. So here this alpha can consist of any variable and string, but we want to restrict to Kuroda's form, like Chomsky's normal form, to make the grammar to be understandable by the parsing. So that is the reason we put the restriction, and we say if we put this restriction with the rules, then the language will be simpler and the same language will be generated. That is the great thing. And you remember, mod of beta must be greater than alpha, except is it can go only start variable go to epsilon. Whenever start variable can go to epsilon, then the mod of right hand side can go, but that is the only exception. If that is the exception is the rule, if many rules mod of right hand side less than, then it is called type 0 grammar. That is the example of type 0 grammar. There is no difference between type 0 and type 1. Type 0 grammar say there is no such restriction, and type 1 grammar the restriction is mod of beta must be greater than or equal to mod of alpha, that is length. Only one exception, when the start variable go to epsilon. The concept of context sensitive grammar introduced by Noam Chomsky, again the same person, Noam Chomsky, every derivation length of the string is never decreases, must be because right hand side is always greater or equal to. The term context sensitive comes for the normal form for this of the grammar, like this relation context sensitive, they permit this thing. I follow this particularly today's lecture, I follow fully chapter 7. I just show you what is, today we have covered the chapter 7 of context free language from Ullman's book. These are already, all these things are known to you. This is Chomsky's normal form, eliminating useless symbol. You know, any context free grammar, if you find a variable left hand side which doesn't goes to generated terminal, that means it is useless. Okay, say, and or any variable you see left hand side which cannot be reached from start variable, that is also useless. So these are useless symbols you should get rid of, then you try to convert to Chomsky's normal form. So I have taken examples in our class, we have go for 6 plus book, and this is another example here. The useless symbol you must, and always after eliminating this, you always take a new start zero symbol, S0. What is the advantage? If you take a new start zero symbol, you are damn sure that S is not there on the right hand side. So because S start symbol should be different. So there it is mentioned. Yeah, that is, I say, computing, generating and reachable symbol. That will check manually, and this has to be done by manually. This is the checking of this. Eliminating epsilon production, that I have told, whenever the eliminating epsilon production, there are maybe 2 or 3 epsilon production, you cannot go all together. You take one rule epsilon production, then go for next epsilon production, so that you have to recursive. Not, you cannot go simultaneously epsilon production, removing epsilon production. Epsilon production can be only be given to start variable, no other. If you find any other variable other than start going to epsilon, you replace with epsilon, and more number of rules will be generated from there. Maybe another variable goes to epsilon, then you remove that epsilon next step. These are simple, not at all tough. You just read those theorem, the proof is not beyond the syllabus, but you know that the complement of context free grammar is not context free grammar, intersection of context free grammar with a regular grammar is a context free grammar. There are lots of questions, MCQ questions comes on that. Eliminating unit production, definitely. Chomsky's normal form, I detail, I have covered. Sifser's book treatment is also good. This book is also good. You can either follow Sifser's or Ullman. Grayback normal form, I have already covered. It says the left hand side should start with a single terminal and all variable. No, not necessarily 2 or 1. Single terminal and all variable. Grayback normal form can be S grammar when the starting terminal with the only one rule, so that looking at the left hand rule, you can know which rule to file. Grayback normal form and S grammar is very, you can relate. S grammar is a subset of Grayback normal form, but unfortunately, all our programming languages cannot be written in S grammar. If it can be written in S grammar, then it will be ON, our parsing will be ON. But we know we use the infix notation, expression, all this, it cannot be done by S grammar. Conversion of any grammar to Grayback normal form, that is not required, it is not in our syllabus. Even conversion of a Enigma to Chomsky's normal form, it is within the syllabus, but generally I have not seen the question comes, but you should be aware of it. Thank you very much.